Hello everyone, welcome back to the channel Marginal Revolution. So today we're gonna start discussing the Cambridge approach to the quantity theory of money. So we have already dealt with the transaction version and income version of Fisher's quantity theory of money. Now we're on to the Cambridge approach, which is quite good, interesting, and explains the behavioral aspects of entire mechanism that we studied in our previous lectures. Alright, so without further ado, let's just get started. So what exactly the Cambridge approach is? So basically, it is a version of quantity theory of money that focuses on the demand for money. So definitely, it is the quantity theory of money, just like we have one Fisher version. But Fisher version was about the supply of money, but Cambridge focuses on the demand for money. But in the equilibrium position, we know that money supply is equal to money demand, so there is not much of a difference. But either way, it broadens our understanding, so we'll look into this right now. So definitely, Cambridge is a university's name, so name comes from the academicians who were there in the Cambridge University, that are Alfred Marshall and A.C. Pigou, who demonstrated a proportional relationship between the quantity of money and the aggregate price level. Quite simple, quite easy, but it is less mechanical than the transaction or the Fission version, as I have already explained. Now, Cambridge approach deals with how much is the optimal amount of money that people should be holding, because definitely we know that currency held in the hand yields no income. Money lying into our cupboard, they give no value to us. They has to be invested somewhere. Money has to be spent somewhere in order to it being productive. So definitely money, people try to use it in an optimal manner, and this is their demand for money. Alright, what is the demand for money? It is definitely for convenience, because we can immediately go to a store and buy anything we need because we have money. So everyone would be willing to offer us the goods that we need. So convenience is there. Further, to meet unexpected obligations. So any unexpected obligation, as the name entails, it is unexpected. So yeah, anything money gonna help us in these very regards. All right now, definitely these two are positive points, that is convenience and the ability to meet unexpected obligations. So as long as these positives outweighs the negatives, and negative is income lost from not investing the money into some productive activity. So as long as positive exceeds the negative thing, people will be holding the money. All right this is what the optimal amount of money people gonna hold. All right now we are on to the Cambridge equation, and this is interesting, that money demand is a proportion of nominal income. MD stands for demand for money. K is a proportion, a stable quantity. Right now, let's forget about stability and all. What we need to understand is, all right K is some proportion, some percentage of what? Of P into Y, and P into Y is what? Nominal income. All right now, this is the assumption that the Cambridge School of Thought have made, that K is assumed to be stable in the short run, which I would say is a realistic assumption, because we are deliberately putting short run period here. So definitely in the short run, we have fixed criteria to spend money, to save money, so it does not change much. For example, we are getting a salary of 1000 P on a monthly basis, so our criteria is definitely that 50% we're gonna keep to ourselves, and rest of the 50 we're gonna spend some, use somewhere. But let's just not complicate the analysis by saying that money gonna be used somewhere, because as per the classical version, money does not have an alternative use. All money's purpose is either to be spent into consumption and investment sort of things, or money is gonna be laid idle form. So this is it. All right so this is our basic assumption, that K is assumed to be stable or constant in the short run. Fair enough. Now, in equilibrium, we know that money supply is equal to money demand, and demand for money is this very thing, that is a proportion of nominal income. All right Now, K is fixed in the short run and real output is determined as before by supply conditions. I have explained this thing thoroughly, so no need for me to repeat this very thing. The Cambridge equation also reduces to a proportional relationship between price level and money supply. Quite easy. So if we are saying that K is stable and real output is also constant, then definitely any increase in money supply is gonna have a direct impact on the price level. But one difference is here, and we're gonna go into that difference right after this second point. Okay, so what is this point? That V is equal to 1 upon K. So little bit of maths is there. I mean, it's not exactly a maths, just we're gonna use this equation to find the value. So suppose equilibrium position is there, money supply equal money demand. All right, so instead of money demand we can write KP Y bar. All right, M stays here, K comes towards the left, it becomes M divided by K equal to price into Y. Now we know that 1 upon K is actually V. How come 1 upon K is V? So we can understand this with the help of an example. Let's say I don't have a styler here, so you can note it down in your copy, but either way it's quite simple. You can immediately understand it even without any noting down anything. Okay, so let's say nominal income is 100 rupees and we are saying that value of K is 25%. So 25% of 100 is rupees 25. So 25 rupees, they're gonna, people gonna demand, or people gonna, money demand people of people will be rupees 25. All right, K is 25%, P into Y is 100, 100 divided by 25%, we get 25. All right, now let's assume, explaining something else. Now we're talking about the velocity here. I'm so sorry, friends. So I think we can understand sometime, there's just slip of tongue happens. So we are now talking about the relationship between velocity and 1 upon K. The thing that I've explained, we're gonna come to that here itself, which is not so far, but let's stick to the point in hand. All right, so let's say that 25% is the value of K and nominal income is rupees 100. So we have money demand which is equal to 25, and in order to buy the entire 100 rupee worth of goods and services, we're gonna be needing to use that 25 rupees 4 times. So 4 becomes our velocity. So we can say that the inverse of K is V. This is it. So you can pause and listen to that very portion again if you haven't got hold over it already, but I think it's really simple, so there is no need to explain it any further. All right, so 1 upon K is V. So this is basically the relationship between Cambridge and Fisher version of equation of exchange that author has tried to explain. This is the similarity, but definitely there is differences also. Formally it is same, but we have behavioral differences because Cambridge approach is much better than the Fisher's approach. And why this is so, now we're gonna go into that detail. Proportionality has been arrived only because we have made certain restrictive assumption. We are deliberately saying that value of K is constant, Y is constant. So definitely there is no other way around. In order to make the equality hold, we have to increase the prices. But now we will understand why this is the case in real life also. So now let's assume that the nominal income is rupees 100 and the value of K is 25%. So money demand definitely going to be rupees 25, because 25% of 100 is rupees 25. And let's say money supply is also rupees 25. So we got equilibrium here. Money supply 25, money demand 25, fair enough. Now let's say monetary authority increased the money supply to 50. So it doubled the money supply from 25 to rupees 50. Now what's gonna happen? So we have to maintain the equality here, and for the equality to be maintained, we have to increase the money demand, because money supply is exogenously determined. So this is the assumptions that we have already talked about. How come money demand can be increased now? One method can be to increase the value of K. So instead of it being 25%, if it goes to 50%, then 50% of 100 will be rupees 50. So we'll have the equality re-established, that is 50 rupees money supply, 50 rupees money demand. But definitely we have assumption that K is stable or constant. So only way by which this equality can be re-established is we have to increase the nominal income, because real income is definitely constant, because we are talking about the classical theory here, and classical real income is real output is supply determined, which is always at the full employment level of equilibrium of employment and output. So definitely K is constant. Already we know this thing, we really don't need to keep myself repeating here. So prices only have to go up. So this is, suppose real output is something and prices go down, go up, so that nominal income becomes, instead of 100, it becomes rupees 200. So earlier it was 100, now it is rupees 200, and 25% of 200 will be 50. So we are seeing that by keeping an upward pressure on prices, nominal income has gone up and equality has been re-established. And this is the behavioral aspect that Cambridge tries to explain. It's like Mrunal sir says, like, ek anar sau bimar. Similarly, when people have excess money with them, money supply has gone up but demand has not, people don't need that money, what they gonna do? Definitely they're gonna spend that money into something they need. So if output is constant, then definitely increased demand for commodity gonna put upward pressure on prices. So prices will go up, and this way nominal income will go up, and we'll see the equality between money demand being re-established again. So this is how the Cambridge people have explained this entire thing. So you can read the highlighted portion here, that proportional relationship exists because of the K was constant and real output was fixed. All right, also the school gives us answer to the question about the way money affects the price level. Simply, there is too much money chasing too few goods, so an excess supply of money led to increased demand for commodities and upward pressure on price level. Quite simple, I would say. So this is the Cambridge school of thought, Cambridge approach to the quantity theory of money. It is very, very important. In previous year, many questions have been asked from this very topic. So yes, do read the Freyan chapter number 4 and Cambridge approach thoroughly. Merely watching the video, I would say, will not help you, because we are not approaching an MCQ sort of exam. Questions are quite tricky, I would say. So please open the book and read it thoroughly. Purpose of making videos is just to provide a basic understanding of what exactly is there in the book. It is no way a substitute to the reading things on your own. Okay, so this is it, friends. I have explained the Cambridge, and we are on to the classical aggregate demand curve now. In the next video, we're gonna be discussing this very thing. This again is very interesting, that classical don't have any aggregate demand curve explicitly, and on an implicit basis definitely it's there. So we're gonna go into details in our next lecture. So thank you so much for watching the video, friends. Goodbye.